What exactly is a protocol? I like to make videos that I wish I had when I was younger, and the term protocol really confused me back then. Only after I got more experience with networking, packets, sequence diagrams, it finally clicked for me, and I wanted to try to explain it now to my former self. What is a protocol? We need to start somewhere, and I always like to start with Wikipedia because it provides a good base that we can build upon. But let's ignore the computing category. You know, computers are a modern invention, so obviously a lot of technology is borrowed from the non-technical world. For example, in another video, we looked at a web server and compared it to restaurant servers. So this time, let's see what protocol means in non-computer terms. In sociology and politics, protocol can mean a formal agreement between nation states. And that already is a good definition that will help us. But even better might be that protocol can also mean etiquette. And etiquette is a set of conventional rules of personal behavior in polite society, usually in the form of an ethical code that delineates the expected and accepted social behaviors. Sounds confusing, but let's simplify and slightly rewrite the sentence. A protocol is a set of rules of behavior, usually in the form of a code that describes the expected behavior. And that is a really good definition of a computer protocol. Just a set of rules on how computer systems or programs should behave. I know this feels very abstract, but let's go through one practical example to see how this is the case in reality. Let's start with HTTP, the Hypertext Transfer Protocol. Clearly, it is a protocol. You may have seen HTTP requests before. You can, for example, use the browser DevTools to kind of see it, but better is an HTTP proxy like Burpsuit or Fiddler. And when I open this website, you can see here the raw HTTP request. So this text is really sent by the browser, the HTTP client, to the web server. And the web server understood this message and responded with an HTTP response, which again the browser understands how to read. And the fact that the browser can send some weird text like this and the server understands it, and then the server responds and the browser understands this response, that is thanks to the fact that the HTTP protocol is well described. There exists a formal agreement between these two parties on how to communicate with each other. And here is the document. This is the RFC 9112. It's an internet standard. It was written by the Internet Engineering Task Force, IETF, or specifically it was updated by these authors here working at these companies apparently. And they describe here how the HTTP protocol version 1.1 is supposed to work. And this is an extremely detailed rule book. It really tries to explain everything. Actually, let's take on the role of a server for a moment. Somebody sends us this text, and according to the RFC rulebook, we now try to understand what was sent to us. So how can we understand this HTTP message? This syntax notation might be confusing when you have never seen something like this, but it's actually pretty simple, and hopefully when you see me walking through it, it becomes somewhat clear how to read it. So here we can see that an HTTP message actually is made up of multiple parts. The first part is called start line, followed by CRLF, which stands for carriage return and line feed, which basically just means a new line. So we have a section called start line, followed by a new line. But what is start line exactly? Well, obviously this is described as well. A HTTP message can either be a request from a client to a server or a response from server to client. So either the start line is a request line or a status line. In our case, we have an HTTP request, so the line is actually a request line. And what is a request line? We can find this here. It's no surprise. A request line also consists of multiple parts. By the way, SP stands for space, which means we have a method, space, request target, space, HTTP version. And slowly we start to really understand each component of the HTTP request. We know that we have a get HTTP method, space, the request target, in our case, slash test, space, and the HTTP version is HTTP 1.1. Of course, this is still not enough. The rabbit hole goes deeper. Everything is clearly defined in this rulebook. For example, the request method is case sensitive. This means if we change the method from uppercase to lowercase, it should not be a valid HTTP request message anymore. We can test this. If we send this request like this, we can see that the server responds with a HTTP 400 bad request. It is a bad request because we didn't follow exactly the rules as it was defined in this document. And I think you slowly can get the idea. This RFC is a very long document describing all the rules of behavior, almost like a contract or formal agreement for how hypertext transfer protocol is supposed to work. Of course, these rules are just written in text, but I think you can imagine that you can take this text and develop a program that exactly implements those rules, write code that automatically does what we just did by hand. And it's really important that we have these detailed rule books because thanks to this internet standard, you can have different programs to fulfill the same roles. Whether you use browsers like Chrome, Firefox or Safari, or command-line tools like curl or wget, it doesn't matter because all of them implement the rules for how HTTP works. They can all be used to talk to servers like Nginx or Apache, which also implement HTTP. I hope this already gives you a really good understanding of what it means to have a protocol. Protocols are important to computers, like languages are important to humans. We humans made up rules for languages, grammar, sentence structures, and if I speak a language another human understands, we communicate with each other. So if you have two different programs like Firefox, a browser, and Nginx, a web server, and then they speak the same language, HTTP, they can communicate with each other. And actually, when you implement a web API for your own website, you also just invented a new protocol. For example, Twitter has an API to look up tweets. Obviously, there's no standardized protocol on how to do that, so Twitter had to invent their own protocol. Usually we call it an API, but you see, it's also just a set of rules. Specifically, you do it using the HTTP protocol. The HTTP protocol already solves part of the problem, which is how to communicate between a browser and a web server. But in order to get the tweets, you have to use HTTP in a very specific way. So you have to send an HTTP request to this endpoint with these values, and then you get back the tweets. This is really also just another protocol on top of HTTP. This stacking of protocol on top of each other, HTTP uses TCP, and then for example the Twitter API uses HTTP, this is something very common and can be seen a lot. OSI layer model and so forth. Keep this in mind because in another video I want to talk more about this, but to make this video not too long I want to just focus on the layers individually. I think this should really help a lot to understand what it means to have a protocol. But it's not everything. And so next let's look at the transmission control protocol, TCP. Hopefully you have heard of it before from TCP IP, TCP sockets or so. Obviously, there's also an RFC for it, a detailed document describing exactly what the transmission control protocol TCP is. And very similar to the HTTP RFC, in here we also describe the language, the message that system sends to each other. The nice thing about HTTP was that it was really text-based, actual English words you can read. Unfortunately, with TCP, it gets a bit more complex because now we actually work with actual bits and bytes, so raw binary data. But here it is described. This reads a bit different than the HTTP syntax from before, but it's also pretty simple. This is basically a TCP message, and it also consists of multiple parts. The source port, the destination port, the sequence number, acknowledge number, some flags, a checksum, and some data. But all of this is binary data. You could count here how many bits each value uses or simply see below. For example, the source port is 16 bits long, so 2 bytes. Same the destination port, or the sequence number is a 32-bit number. But binary data is a bit annoying to work with. Luckily, we have tools like Wireshark which decode and show us data in a human-readable way. Let me quickly set up a small experiment. I sniff all network traffic on my system, then I open up httpliveoverflow.com in the browser, so we send an HTTP request, then I filter for the HTTP protocol in Wireshark, and we see now the request and response. As you can see, Wireshark recognizes that this is HTTP request and response data, but we are not interested in HTTP, we want to learn more about TCP. And as you can see here, HTTP is actually sent and received using TCP. And here we can see the source port, the destination port, the sequence number, acknowledge number, different flags, and so forth. You can find here all the data as described in the RFC. But actually, this doesn't show us everything about TCP. When I right-click on this entry and I say follow TCP stream, we can get all TCP packets related to this HTTP request and response. And suddenly we see a lot more TCP packets. And here we finally learn about the second important part of what is a protocol. A protocol is not just the message itself, but it also describes rules on how and when the messages are used. Let's see this for the case of TCP. Maybe you have heard of the three-way handshake, SYN, SYN, ACK, ACK. Fun fact, in reality, it's four steps, but because steps two and three can be combined in a single message, it's called a three-way handshake. Anyway, as you can see here in more detail in the section to establish a connection, it works by system A sending a SYN TCP message to B, including a sequence number, 100, SYN stands for synchronize, and then B responds back to A with an ACK packet, acknowledging, so confirming the reception of the particular sequence message, but then also includes their own SYN packet with a sequence number, and now B waits for A to send back an acknowledge for that. After that, actual data can be now sent, and we can see it nicely in Wireshark. The browser sent a TCP SYN, the server responds with a SYN ACK, then the browser responded with another ACK. After that, data could be sent. So now the browser sends a TCP packet with the added HTTP data. Maybe you wonder why we need to do this weird exchange of SYN and SYN ACK packets. Why is the TCP protocol defining this weird back and forth? Why not just one packet, maybe send HTTP text directly? Well, there are good reasons for why somebody invented TCP and why we decided to use it. First of all, a computer only has one internet connection. So when a computer receives some data, which program on the computer should get this data? This is what the port is for. The TCP packets were sent to port 80, which allowed the operating system to forward the HTTP data to the web server program. So with a port number, you can run a lot of different programs on the same computer using the same network connection. That explains why we have ports, but why do we have this complex sequence of packets back and forth? Why not just send the data with additional port information? Well, you just described UDP, the user datagram protocol. If you compare UDP packets or UDP messages to TCP messages, you can see it's very similar. It has a source port, destination port, checksum, and data, but it's missing other parts like the flag, which indicate if it's a SYN or an ACK packet. And the UDP RFC is very, very short and it's old. It never had to be updated. This is because UDP is extremely simple. It's just this message, no sequence back and forth required. So why don't we use that instead? Well, here comes the reason for why somebody invented TCP. For example, if you would send an HTTP request using UDP to a server, you would wait. You would wait and nothing happens. Does the server even exist? Maybe we wait a bit longer? Oh, then we received the UDP packet, but wait, is that even the correct response to our initial UDP packet? Or did an attacker just send us a fake UDP response? I don't know. That is what TCP tries to solve. TCP first sends a SYN with a sequence number. If we get a TCP ACK packet back with a sequence number plus one, then we know for a fact the server really received the packet. And that's why in the sequence diagram, the client now knows, yes, this connection works. The server can receive and respond to my TCP messages. But the server doesn't yet know if the client can receive its responses, so it also sends a SYN packet with its own sequence number, and when the client responds to that packet with another ACK, including the correct sequence number, the server is now also sure the client can receive all packets. So the connection can be considered established and you can start sending data. And using these sequence numbers, which you can increment for each packet, you also can recognize when data is missing. When you receive sequence number 105 and 107, you know you're missing 106. Maybe it arrives out of order a bit later, or you have to ask for it being retransmitted. And that's why the TCP protocol is so much more complex and requires a very detailed description of exactly how each system has to behave. Here in the RFC is, for example, also a TCP connection state diagram. However, this diagram is only a summary and must not be taken as a total specification. Many details are not included. I know this looks really complex and the details are very complex. I would not want to implement the TCP protocol myself, but you can see here what a protocol really is. A computer protocol is a collection of rules and definitions and specifications of how systems can communicate with each other. And each protocol tries to solve specific problems of communication. But of course, if you cannot find a suitable protocol for you, you could theoretically always invent your own. Also, so far we just focused on classical networking like TCP and HTTP. And I always worry if you just focus on one area, you forget the bigger picture. And there's so much to gain from having broader knowledge. So before we end this video, let me show you one protocol completely unrelated to classical networking. And that is UART, Universal Asynchronous Receiver and Transmitter. This is something from the hardware world. If you have ever done like Arduino programming or hardware hacking, UART or serial is something you might recognize. And while it doesn't have the protocol in the name, it's really a protocol. Look, when I search protocol on the Wikipedia article for UART, you can even see it once being called a protocol. It's a classic example of we humans just making up words to mean something and meaning change or synonyms are used. So while typical UART is not referred to as a protocol, it really just is another protocol. And this protocol basically works with single wires. One wire to transmit and one wire to receive. And the sender and receiver have to agree on exactly the protocol, which means what baud rate to use, how many data bits, how many stop bits. There are variations, but as long as both systems agree on the configuration, you can use UART. So using a single wire with bit 0 or 1, whether it's high or low voltage, you can follow the UART protocol to transmit entire bytes. I know I brushed over it, but it doesn't matter if you understood this. All I want you to take away is that protocols are really important because when systems communicate, we need rules on how to do that. Protocols are everywhere and they are very different. Some protocols are text-based like HTTP, while some protocols are based on raw binary data like TCP and UDP. Some protocols even talk about the expected voltage levels of wires like in UART. Some protocols just have a single message like a UART frame or a UDP packet. Other protocols can define a lot of back and forth interaction like the whole sequence diagram of how connections are established with TCP. Or to just throw another topic into here, to use the Twitter API, you first need to follow the OAuth protocol, which is a protocol defining how using HTTP requests and responses in a specific way you can authenticate or authorize yourself to Twitter and then use the API. You can see. Protocols are everywhere around you. It's really nothing special. They are just a set of rules on how systems communicate with each other. So anytime something sends or receives data, you know it is using some kind of protocol. And just to make a small bridge over to hacking, in order to attack a system, we need to be able to communicate with the system. And that's why it's important for us to learn about different protocols and how to use them. It's kind of obvious. I hope this video about what is a protocol was interesting. If there are other terms from computer science that you find difficult to grasp or you don't know what they mean, or maybe you are a teacher at a school and you know about concepts your students struggle with the most, let me know in the comments below. Maybe I will cover the topic next video. Thanks.